Today on Larry King Now, number one best-selling author Tony Robbins on his first book in nearly 20 years.
And I want to do something at Solutions where I could level the playing field, where I could help people see that you could take the best of what Wall Street knows and show Main Street how they could really apply it for their life, and that's what this book's about.
On advising world leaders.
And I said, you know, I'm not being harsh, Mr. President, in any way. I just want you to know, if you want me to say what you want to hear, I'm the wrong guy. And I'm not saying what I'm saying is right. But if you want another opinion, I'm happy to come. And he laughed, and he was great, and you know, we're friends to this day.
Plus, hidden talent.
Hidden talent. Gosh. Being quiet. Just kidding.
All next on Larry King Now. Welcome to Larry King Now, our guest and old and dear friend, Tony Robbins, best-selling author, entrepreneur, philanthropist, and the nation's number one life and business strategist. His audio and video programs have sold more than 50 million copies. More than 4 million people around the world have attended one of his live events, and at a few of them, I appeared. With
true.
His first book in nearly 20 years, Money Master the Game, Seven Simple Steps to Financial Freedom, he's here with us today. Thanks for coming.
Good to see you.
Why has it taken you 20 years to write another book?
I've had a few day jobs. I got a dozen companies. About every 4 days, I'm on an airplane going somewhere. I go to 15 countries. I'm seeing about 250,000 people a year in live events, which I love. But I'll tell you what pushed me over the edge, Larry, is 2008. When I started seeing people losing their homes en masse, when I saw people losing half their net worth, and I knew it was because of manipulation. And I grew up, very poor financially, like no money at Thanksgiving, no money for food. So it wasn't statistics to me. And so I thought, the government's going to do something. And after 2 years when nothing happened, I thought, I'm going to be part of the solution, not the problem. And most people don't know it, but I've been coaching Paul Tudor Jones, one of the top 10 financial traders literally in the history of the world. He's not lost money for 21 straight years. I worked with him 21 straight years. So if you imagine the tech crash, he made money. 2008, lost 50%. He made 28%. So I thought, if I could take everything I've learned from him, Larry, and interview 50 of the smartest people in the world, hedge fund guys, guys that started with nothing, became billionaires, Nobel laureates, and put it into a simple action plan that a mom could use, that a baby boomer could use, that a kid getting out of school, millennial, could use to turn things around, it'd be a great project. So it's been 4 years, but I'm really proud to bring it out, and it's now starting to really touch people.
What do you mean we've been manipulated?
Well, most people know that what happened in 2008 was a very small number of people made some decisions that had nothing to do with the markets. They took undue risks, and unfortunately, we bailed them all out.
Banks, mostly, right?
Mostly banks. But some of those same individuals were put back in charge. If anybody wants to really know the story, they can watch Inside Job. It's probably the best documentary ever made about it. But when you're done, that's what pushed me over the edge, that specific documentary. It won the Academy Award. Matt Damon did the voiceover. But at the end, you either want to kill somebody, you're so angry, or you're totally depressed because there's no solutions. And I want to do something at Solutions where I could level the playing field, where I could help people see that you could take the best of what Wall Street knows and show Main Street how they could really apply it for their life. And that's what this book's about.
Steve Forbes, good friend of ours, said, Robbins has produced a book that will appeal to both the beginner and the most sophisticated money jockey overseeing multi-billions of dollars in assets. If there were a Pulitzer Prize for investment books, this one would win hands down. Is he one of the people you interviewed?
Yes, he is. Yeah, he's amazing, and that's an amazing quote. I saw that. He sent that out, I guess, a blog about the book. But yeah, what's unique about this book, Larry, is we're not hearing from talking heads on television who are pumping you up about what to do. And this is not me pumping you up saying what to do. There's not a word in here that's from me around finances. It's me investing the best and saying, what does the average person do go from where they are to where they want to be? And I think the biggest mistake people make is you hear people say, you know, I don't have any money, and it's true. But if you look at what makes people wealthy, it's not winning the lottery. Those people are usually broke. The sports stars, you and I both know, 10 years later, often are very broke. What makes it is taking a small amount of money and compounding it. And the best example that I give is, there's a gentleman who worked for UPS. His name is Theodore Johnson. He never made more than $14,000 in a year, Larry. That's the most he ever made. But at the age of 75, he was worth $70 million. Now, how the hell do you do that? Well, a friend of his said to him, you'd say you have no money, but if the government came in and taxed you, you'd never see the money and the government would get it. So we're gonna put a 20% tax. You're never gonna see it. It's gonna go in an investment account. Over 50 plus years, that made him $70 million. So You talk to Warren Buffett and say, what made you the richest man in the world? He says three things. One, living in America where the opportunity is. He said two, good genes, living a long time. And three, compound interest. And most of us know about it, but we don't use it. So I show people how to get started with that. You don't want to own an Apple phone if you don't own Apple, or better yet, the index, all the best companies in the world.
Now, you're used to telling people what to do.
Yes.
In this book, you're learning, right?
Yes, exactly.
You were not a financial expert, were you?
Well, I had a certain amount of expertise, truthfully, because I'd worked with Paul Tudor for 21 years, so I had quite an inside look at things. But the biggest education I got was how little I knew.
What surprised you the most?
I'd say fees was the biggest piece. I'd say the other thing is, what was it that these people were obsessed with? Two obsessions they have. The first obsession, ironically, is not losing money. You think that these people take these giant risks, Larry, and that's how they became billionaires. Actually, they do something. They all are focused on not losing money because they know they're going to be wrong. But then they have a second focus, which is they call it asymmetrical risk reward. Big word. It just means they take the least amount of risk possible to get the biggest reward. So Paul Tudor Jones, for example, has a rule. And when I started working with him, he hadn't used it for a while, and he brought it back out. He's used it for 21 years. He asked himself, if I'm going to invest this dollar, am I certain I'm going to make five? If I risk a dollar in risking five and I'm wrong, I can risk another dollar, still be okay. I can be wrong. I can be wrong 4 out of 5 times and do okay. And he's not wrong 4 out of 5 times.
Do they learn when they lose?
They all learn when they lose, and they usually have a strategy to protect themselves from losing. That's really one of the biggest secrets for them.
All right, but you say this is for anybody. I'll give you an inner city kid in Philadelphia. His father ran away. His mother cleans houses.
Yes.
He can learn.
He can learn, because the first thing we all have to do is we have to become an owner, an investor, no matter how little money we have. That's why I use the example of Theodore Johnson, because it's so important. Because if you just don't see it and you put it aside, it'll change. I'll tell you another thing people can do, say they have no money. I interviewed all these behavioral economists. These are the guys that spend their entire life trying to figure out, why is it in human nature we mess up so much on money, and how do we trick ourselves to do the right thing? And one of them came up with this genius plan, which has been proven now over 15 years. It's called Save More for Tomorrow. So you say you have no money today. This young man is just getting started. The best thing he could do is take a percentage, and it's a tax. He doesn't notice it. It goes straight to his account. But if somebody right now says, I can only put aside 5%, 3%, they went to this group of people, blue-collar workers, and said, put aside 3.5%. You'll never miss it. It'll be gone before you know it. But here's what I want you to do. You go to your employer and say, every time you get a raise, 3.5% of that is going to go, of your money, is going to go straight to the same account. You're never going to see it. So if you got a 10% raise, you're going to really see a 6.5% raise. But the rest is going to take care of your future. These families that did this in this Midwestern town, over 10 years, the average person was saving 14%. 65% were saving 18%. That's like the same guy from UPS. When you do that over as many years as you've lived, you got quite a fortune on your hand.
What happens when leaders around the world call you up for advice? We'll find out next. We're back with Tony Robbins. His new book is Money, Master the Game: 7 Simple Steps to Financial Freedom. Any common thread that runs through all these successful people?
Gosh, I'd say the number one common thread of anybody that I work with is successful. Financial, athletes, people in politics, it's hunger. You know, you and I both know intelligence is a pretty damn valuable tool, but there are a lot of very smart people who can't fight their way out of a paper bag. And then when you find somebody who has that hunger, the hunger that doesn't go away, that hunger to be more, to do more, to give more, that hunger that never ends, you know, that's how you get these people that are the best in the world at whatever they do. And so if you can, I think everybody has that hunger, but for some people it's been asleep for a long time because they're afraid. They're afraid that I'm gonna get hungry, I'm gonna try, I'm gonna fail. And so it's human nature to protect yourself from the fear by just lowering your expectations. But one of the things I've learned is you get what you tolerate. You get what you tolerate in yourself, you get what you tolerate in your life, and sooner or later, we sometimes hit a point where we say, not another day, not another hour, this is done. I'm not walking this way, I'm not talking this way, I'm not living this way, I'm not gonna be in this relationship anymore, I'm gonna change it. And when people do that, that's the beginning of a breakthrough.
When you advised, like, President Clinton,
yes,
you didn't advise him on whether he should sign the SALT Treaty.
No.
Or whether he should pass this bill.
No, of course
not. So what would presidents call upon you for?
Well, you know, what people call upon me for, unless they talk about it, I don't talk about it, because that's why I get the phone call, because they want that privacy. But overall, at that stage, the first time I got the phone call was 1 year after he was in office. It was Christmas time, and he asked me if I would come to Camp David and talk. And it wasn't hard to figure out the challenge. He'd lost both houses of Congress. He'd lost from, you know, if the economy is stupid, to not having a clear agenda in terms of the American people knowing what he's about. And he actually called me at a mutual friend of ours, Peter Gruber's house, and said, you know, I wonder if you'd come visit with me. And I said, it'd be a privilege, Mr. President, and I'd be happy to come tonight, you know, Christmas. And I said, I'd be happy to do it, but I said, I'm not a fan. And, you know, I remember Peter looking at me like, are you crazy? He's mouthing to me. It's the President of the United States. And I said, you know, I'm not being harsh, Mr. President, anyway. I just want you to know, if you want me to say what you want to hear, I'm the wrong guy. And I'm not saying what I'm saying is right. But I, if you want another opinion, I'm happy to come. And he laughed, and he was great. And, you know, we're friends to this day. But at that time, it was like, how do I get out of this rut that I'm in where I feel out of control, where the media is running my story? Right? That was really the issue that was being dealt with. And I'm not a media expert, but I know one thing. If you don't do anything, the story will change if you're the President of the United States, right? But you want to do things. You got to decide, how are you going to communicate? What are you going to do? And you got to stop blaming what's outside yourself, because things are unfair. The media can be more than fair. The media can be unfair. We all know the media is like people. People are fair, people are unfair. So for the most part, you wouldn't get where you were without the media. You certainly with the President of the United States. So helping him to decide what he was going to do at that stage. Also later in his life, you know, when he wasn't going to be president anymore, what do I do? I'm, you know, 51 years old. Where am I going to go? Those are the types of things. And he's, what he's done with his life since leaving the presidency is unbelievable. I think he has more influence today than he did back then.
He'd be elected in a sweep.
Oh, in a heartbeat.
Have you met Obama?
Okay, yes, I have.
What do you think of him?
Brilliant, smart as a tack. Had a passionate conversation with him with a large number of billionaires in the room who are his biggest supporters, saying, you know, I voted for you the first time. If you are going to do this again, how are you going to do it with a divided country? This is right before the second election. And I said, I'm not being harsh. You're going to probably win anyway. But I really love to know, because you've demonized the other side. They've demonized you, but you're the leader, right? Leaders got to go first, you know? And second question I said is, why didn't you take Simpson Bowles? Because you had both guys at the table willing to do it on the most difficult issue of our time. So if I got a second issue of my question, and the room kind of changed, because it was a fundraising room with $250,000 to be in the room for each person. But the president was great. And he said, well, Tony, he goes, look, he said, I've never demonized anybody. And I said, okay. He goes, that's never what I've done. And he said, secondly, he said, on Simpson Bowles, your friends on Wall Street, you know, they wouldn't like, you know, giving up the remainder interest. And I said, well, I don't just have friends on Wall Street. And he said, and the American people wouldn't like the mortgage deduction going away. And he said, I have a better plan. I said, Mr. President, you do have a better plan, probably. I believe it. But the problem is your own party's not voting for it. So it's not better if it can't be passed. And I think the biggest challenge in leadership for anyone today is, how do we get past right versus wrong? It used to be, and you're old enough, and I'm old enough to remember, when guys would fight like hell on the House floor, and then they go have a beer together.
Right.
Today, they don't even talk to each other.
That's right.
It's like you're evil. And I think I had the chance to meet President Gorbachev and spend 3 or 4 hours with him on a plane. I took him on a flight to meet President George Sr. and a group of people, President Mitterrand and a whole group of people, about 100 of us together. So we spent this time, and I said, when did the Cold War end? And he gave me this, you know, speech that he's given a million times, and I said, 3 more hours. When did the Cold War end? I want to know the moment. And he's, I said, you're not getting by with this. And I was teasing him. He started to laugh. So he finally thought for a while, and he said something I think is really instructive about leadership. He said, the Cold War ended with the end of demonization. And I said, what was the moment that ended? And he said, let me think. And he thought for a while, and then he started laughing and hitting his you know, side of his arm, my leg like this, and laughing. And he's talking to his translator, and he said, I can tell you the moment. He said, President Reagan was lecturing me on the evils of communism. And he called us the evil empire. And I was lecturing him on the evils of supposed capitalism. And he said, we're going madder and madder, back and forth, back and forth. At one point, he said, Reagan stared at me. He said, I could feel I was so mad. And he just stood up. And he walked and took 4 steps away from me. And he turned around, came back and said, hi, my name's Ron. Can I call you Mikhail? And shook his hand. Like, and he started laughing. He goes, you had to love the guy. And he said that Reagan then also said to him, I want you to bring some Russian children to America. He knew that Gorbachev loved children. And if they're the evil empire, that wouldn't be normal. And that break of demonization is where they started making conversations the first time as human beings.
Tony's childhood and how it informed his career when we get back. The book, Money Master the Game. Don't go away. Steve Forbes calls it a goldmine of money-making information. Money, Master the Game, 7 Simple Steps to Financial Freedom. Secrets from the world's greatest financial minds, from the number one best-selling author, Tony Robbins. I want to divert a little.
Sure.
People in despair, what do you say to the people of Ferguson, the black people of Ferguson?
Well, I think it's the nation right now. Ferguson is in pain, but I think the whole nation's in pain. I mean, you see these, you know, riots breaking out, and also people peacefully working all over the country. I think what you have to say is we hear you. I think every person in this country has to know whether or not you were sitting in that courtroom, whether or not you think it was fair or not. Even if it was a fair legal process, this has happened so many times that people are at their threshold. And the only good that I can find in it is most things don't change till they hit a threshold. Now, someone who's violent and destroys an African-American store in Ferguson under the excuse of this, to me, that's unconscionable. Whether it be white, black, brown, purple, I don't care. You don't hurt other people because you were hurt. That's especially in that situation. That's just hurtful. But people, white, black, brown, people all over the country and all around the world saying this has to stop, I think that's a damn good sign. I think social media has helped to spread it. And I think the question is, the people that are serious, what do we do? I think it's a real test of leadership for the president, for police officers and police organizations to see how do we change this perception and reality, because there's a combination of both or wouldn't be out there. And what do we in our local communities do to make those changes actually happen? So it's not an easy task, not a simple task, but I think being at threshold, as painful as it is, that's the only good. That I think out of horrific situations, some good must come, and that's the good that can come from this.
Now, you took a bad upbringing, a tough upbringing, and made it good. You had a mother who had problems, alcoholic and everything. Did that, you think that drove you?
Oh, there's no question. I mean, I hate suffering. I hate to see anybody suffer, but that's because I've experienced it and I've witnessed it with so many people I care about. And I mean, you know, this book, I've donated all the profits to this book in advance, and I didn't do that for some positioning. I've been feeding people. I was fed at 11 years old. We had no money, no food. It changed my life, not because somebody gave me the food. It changed my life because my parents had always said that strangers don't give a damn. So I had evidence that somebody gave a damn. And so I promised I'd do something. So at 17, I fed two families, then four, then
you were
eight.
Alone at 17, right?
At 17, I was. But I started out feeding with that time. And, I fed 42 million people over my life. But I decided when I did this, they cut food stamps, $8.7 billion a year ago. And I said, look, you can't get rid of 2 million people and just pretend they're not there. I work with all these organizations. So I called up and I said, Feeding America, they're the best organization, the largest reach in this country for feeding people. And I said, if I gave you all the donation of all this in advance, what could I do? They said, you could feed 10 million people. I said, I'm in. But as the years gone by, I've gotten more inspired, so I'm writing an additional check. So today I launched it on Giving Tuesday, and I'm feeding 50 million people myself, 50 million meals, and then I'm offering anybody who wants to come in, I'm matching what they're doing, so we can feed 100 million people, and I just want to bring attention to it.
How did you get into motivating people? How did that start? I've spoken at some of your conferences.
Yes,
I just bring humor. In fact, why am I here? But you are wild at these things.
Yes.
I mean, you really get them going.
Yes.
How'd you start? How'd you start doing that?
I started reading when I was just a kid. I needed something to feed my mind. And I had all the suffering and I didn't have a way to escape. Books were my escape. That's why I love books so much. It's like I could learn from somebody from another century. I could learn by another person's life experience. And then I started to do some speaking and touching people that way. But honestly, it's never been motivation for me. It's always been strategy, because motivation without strategy is like a warm bath. You know, you should take a bath or you're gonna be dirty regularly. You need inspiration. But it's strategy too. But I know you're never going to hear the strategy unless we can move you. I mean, I do a weekend that's 50 hours. So Oprah comes and says, Tony, I love you to death, but no one sits for more than 3 hours. I can't do it. And 12 hours later, she's standing in her chair looking at the camera going, this is one of the greatest experiences of my life. Or Usher, you know, comes to me and says, Tony, I can't do 50 hours, dude. I just can't. You know, 50 hours later, he's like, I laughed my ass off. This is one of the most incredible experiences of my life. So I've learned a way to refine the process to move people so that they act. If you just get pumped up, what good does it have? So this book is all these specific strategies. Here's what to do. Here's what Ray Dalio says, the largest hedge fund on earth. I say to him, don't inspire me. Tell me, if your kids couldn't get any of your money, not on a dime, and you were gonna show them what to do, what would you show them? What would you tell them? He said, Tony, I've spent 10 years of my life refining this process. All my money's in it. It's called my all-weather strategy, because it works when the stock market goes up or down. And he said, I've tested it back to 1925. It makes money 85% of the time. So he tells me the strategy, which is quite complex. And when you show it to the average financial person, they go, oh, that'll never work, because they're not Ray Dalio. They haven't figured out $160 billion to manage. It takes $5 billion 10 years ago, net worth, and $100 million for him to talk to you. Now he won't do that for even that for any amount of money. But he spent 3 hours with me. At the end, he shows me this formula. I said, you know what? This is great, but you showed me how to make a chocolate cake. It's very inspiring. You said use some chocolate, use some sugar. But I need the actual numbers, or no one's going to be able to act on this. They're never going to figure this out on their own. And he said, Tony, that's my secret sauce. He said, that's how I get billions of dollars. I said, yeah, but you've not taken money in 10 years. I said, you're a generous man. You've given, what, half of your net worth you're going to give away? Give me the formula. Give it to me. And I was teasing him. He gave it to me. It's in the book. It's one of the formulas. And when you test it over the last 75 years, it's been successful 85% of the year, time, year by year. And the times it's lost, it only lost 1.6% on average. The biggest loss was less than 4% in a world where the markets go up 50% down, back
and forth. This book's going to make people money.
It'll make people money. The beautiful part of it is they don't have to pick Ray. They can decide who they want to follow because I give you the strategies of all the best people.
Are all the people rich, or did you talk to some economists?
I talked to economists. I talked to Nobel laureates. I covered
both
sides.
Not necessarily rich, but advise people.
Because I wanted to make sure I saw both sides, not just that built it. But I really wanted to put most of my focus on those that have started with nothing and built real fortunes.
None of these were born rich.
Not a single one.
Tony will answer your social media questions after this. The book, Money Master the Game. We'll be right back. We're back with Tony Robbins, the new book, Money, Master the Game. He doesn't make a penny from it, right?
That's correct. Giving away 100%.
Wow. How do you, the energy, do you ever lose your energy? Do you ever go down?
Well, sure. I get exhausted. I get mad. I get tired. I'm a human being, but it's like an athlete. You know, you built your muscle, so it's there for you. It doesn't last. What used to last when I was a kid, you know, a month might last me a few minutes or an hour, you know, something of that nature. A
couple of social media questions. Linker Cassis on Instagram. What do you believe is the most dangerous assumption people are making about financial freedom around the world?
Oh my gosh, there's so many. I think the biggest thing is putting yourself in a place where finance is so complex that you just trust somebody else to do it for you. And yet sometimes people say, but how am I gonna solve this? I mean, that's why I wrote the book. It's like you can hire a lawyer, but you better understand that your life is on the line. You can hire someone to teach your child, but you better know it's your child and you got to still do it. You can go listen to someone about religion, but you're going to have to make your own choices. And I think we have to educate ourselves because otherwise you wake up and there's nothing here. I think right now, people just assuming that the market's going to go up forever. We've had a very long bull market here coming up on 6 years. So, I mean, this is a situation that doesn't go on forever, and you have to have a way to protect yourself, and that's part of asset allocation, which we talk about.
Jack Barrier on Twitter. What were the most impactful lessons you learned while writing this book?
I would say, there's so many. I would say the biggest thing is seeing what's really possible, that somebody with vision and caring and who's willing to work their tail off to learn can take small risks and become incredibly successful. My assumption was somebody like, you know, Sir Richard Branson, you'd assume, you know, you see him out there taking these life risks. He risks his life, but he doesn't risk in business. I mean, if you look at Richard, I believe when he was opening up Virgin Air, big risk to buy these giant airplanes. But his question always is, what's the worst case and how do you protect it? And so, you know, he made a deal with, I believe it was Boeing, if I remember correctly, he could give back those planes if over X amount of period of time it didn't work out. He's covering his downside. The average American isn't doing that. So I think it blew my mind to see that these people are risk takers, but it's very calculated risk. It's small risk with big rewards. That's what set them apart.
Any of them women?
Yes. Mary Callan Erdos is just a genius. She's head of J.P. Morgan, manages $2.5 trillion with a T dollars. Moved up from nothing, built it straight up. Extraordinary human being. The interview's in there with her as well.
Silvera Keela, what's your favorite book of all time, and what are your morning routines?
Favorite book of all time is hard, but I've been asked that before, so I have thought about it. And I think it's so hard to pick one. But if I had to pick one, I'd say Man's Search for Meaning by Viktor Frankl. The experience, every one of us in our lives are going to experience extreme stress. Losing a family member, I've been told, you know, a tumor in your brain, financial stresses, whatever it is. But when you see the ultimate stress of somebody who went through Auschwitz and how they survived and how the people that did survive made it, and you read it in first-person account, you realize you have no problems. And it's just a beautiful book. And it reminds you that life is not about being happy. It's not about fun. It's not about money. It's about meaning. And even in your suffering, there can be meaning. But I'd say my routines is, my life is different every day, but there's one thing I do constantly. I call it priming. Every day I get up and I take a minimum of 10 minutes, and it's not a meditation, but it has a meditative quality. And I sit and I do something physically to change my state. I usually jump in cold or hot water. I have these, if I'm in my homes, I have these 56 degree cold plunges I do to just change everything.
You're out of your mind.
Or I use a river when I'm in Sun Valley. But the point of the matter is I do a radical change. I do this breathing pattern, and then I take 10 minutes and I do 3.5 minutes of feeling associated for all things I'm grateful for. Not just thinking of it intellectually, but feeling it. Because when you're grateful, there's no fear. When there's grateful, there's no anger. You can't have those emotions simultaneously. And so cultivating or priming it so it's always on the edge for me, I'm always feeling that daily, is important to me. And then I do 3.5 minutes of focused on healing and strengthening the best parts of me, and the same for my friends. It's kind of like a prayer. And then I do 3 minutes of the top 3 things. I call them the 3 to thrive that I want to accomplish, and I see them as done. And when I'm done in that 10 minutes, I'm ready to rock and roll.
At Scott Edwards, JB, how did Jim Rohn affect you?
Jim Rohn was my original mentor, and he shaped my life philosophically. He's the guy that taught me really that for things to change, you got to change. For things to get better, you got to get better.
What does he do?
He's passed away. A few years ago, I was at his funeral. But he was a seminar speaker. It was the first. I didn't know what a seminar was. And a friend of mine, I went to work for somebody. I was in high school, 17 years old, and I was working on the side to try and make money to be able to support my family. And I was moving furniture for this man. And my father said, he used to be such a loser, and now he's so successful, you know? So when you're a kid, you can say these things. I said, my dad said, you're such a loser, and now you're so successful. He said, what? I said, how'd you do it? He goes, I went to this seminar. So it was $35. He explained it was 3.5 hours. And at that time, I was making $40 a week as a janitor. And I took a week's pay, and I went to this seminar, and I listened to this man who I eventually went to work for. And so he powerfully influenced me philosophically.
A little game of if you only knew. I just throw some questions at you. Who's the first girl you ever kissed?
Oh, my gosh. Her name was Pam, and I can't remember her last name, but I remember her vividly.
How old were you?
I was 5.
5? What's a superpower you'd love to have?
Invisibility.
Me too. Time period you'd love to go back and visit?
The Renaissance.
Would you rather hit a home run or catch a touchdown pass?
Oh, my gosh, that's a tough one. I think I hit a home run would be pretty awesome.
Me too. Favorite author? Viktor Frankl?
Viktor Frankl, probably, yeah.
What motivates you?
My wife. My wife is the greatest gift in my life, no exaggeration. She's given me more joy than anything that I've ever experienced outside my kids and my work.
Person you look up to?
I look up to people that stand up. And I look at people in business. I have some dear friends that are people that have just shown up. But I also look at people historically. Maya Angelou is an extraordinary person. I had the privilege of meeting, you know, Mother Teresa, the privilege of meeting Nelson Mandela. I still look up to them.
Best thing about your job?
Complete diversity. It's different every day. One day I'm working with a celebrity athlete. Another day I'm working with a child. I'm working with somebody that's suicidal. I'm doing an event with 5 or 10,000 people. It's pretty amazing.
Hidden talent.
Hidden talent. Gosh. Being quiet.
Pet peeve.
Pet peeve. People that are uncaring to other human beings drives me crazy.
Me too. Music on your iPod.
Oh my gosh, what's on there now? I think I was listening to actually Diddy right now.
Time travel or space travel?
Time travel.
Favorite vacation spot?
Fiji.
You're the best, Tony.
Good to see you again.
The book is Money, Master the Game. I want to thank my guest, Tony Robbins, and be sure to grab a copy of this new book, the subtitle, 7 Simple Steps to Financial Freedom. It's out right now, and you can find me on Twitter at King's Things, and I'll see you next time.